Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Jeanette Shellberg. We are here with Richard Shellberg and Mr. Blasco Michael Mollet, who is a veteran of World War II, United States Marine Corps, corporal, and the interview is taking place on January 16th, 2015, in the Camden County Office of Veterans Affairs. So, Mr. Mollet, I'm going to jog your memory a little bit here. Were you drafted or did you enlist?
It's a difficult question to answer because I enlisted in the Navy. And I've never called in the Navy. And then when I became 18, I registered for the draft board because, you know, nobody had taken me. And I actually consider myself enlisting, but I think my records would show that I was drafted.
Okay. So when you say you enlisted in the Navy, you actually went to a recruiting office?
Oh, yes. I passed a physical and everything. The only thing, I wasn't sworn in. And they procrastinated, and I think the reason they procrastinated is because at that time, the draft boards had certain quotas to meet. And it was getting more difficult for them to meet those quotas. So in order to help these draft boards make those quotas, the Armed Services postpone taking the enlistments by a couple of months, so they could be then counted as draftees, and the draft board made their quota.
So for the benefit of future generations who may be looking at this video, you went down and more or less volunteered to go into the Navy. They did your physical, sent you home, never called you back.
Never called me.
And you believe it's because at the time there was a draft, and the people with the draft had to meet certain number of draftees each month, so they held back calling you in so that the draft board could draft you
exactly
instead.
Right, because when I was 18, I turned around that day, went to the draft board and told them I wanted to go in immediately. And the next draft, which was really March 1st, because it was too late for February, I was in the service.
And what year was this?
This was 1943, March of 1943.
Okay. Where were you living at the time?
In Collinswood, New Jersey.
And why did you join?
I was young. I wanted adventure. I had a great love for my country. And I wanted to fight the enemy.
Why did you pick the branch of service?
I picked the Marine Corps because at that time the Marine Corps was the only branch of service that was successful in capturing enemy territory. The 1st Marine Division had captured Guadalcanal and declared it safe in 1942.
Do you remember your first days in the service?
My first day in the service?
First day or first few days?
Yes, I got rude awakening when I had to wake up at, I think, 5 o'clock in the morning, when I had to listen to somebody give orders, when I had to scrub maybe at the bathroom with a toothbrush. I really loved the Marine Corps. I enjoyed it. I think I made a man out of me. It taught me responsibility, and it taught me to judge other people not by the way they look, by just the type they are. I made many friends, and if it wasn't for my mother, I'd have probably made a career out of the Marine Corps.
Do you recall your boot camp or training experiences?
Yes, I recall. I went to Parris Island, where was a boot camp where we were really taught discipline, to follow orders, and went through. They turned around and broke down initially our character and then rebuilt our character up before they sent us out.
Do you remember any of your instructors?
No, not really. Not my drill instructors.
How did you get through boot camp?
I had no problems. I wasn't the best Marine, but I wasn't the worst.
You didn't have any issues with the total change in lifestyle?
Not really, because I was, like I say, I was in the right age. I was 17. I was looking for adventure. I wanted something different, and it filled my needs.
You served in World War II, correct?
Yes. I participated in the invasion of Peleliu and in the invasion of Okinawa. And after the war, under the pretense of disarming the Chinese troops, we moved into northern China and held it till Chiang Kai-shek brought his men and lost it.
The places that you mentioned that you went to, do you remember arriving there and what it was like? And
oh, sure. Sure. My itinerary. I went first to Paris Island. Then after I finished boot camp, they sent me to advanced infantry training, which was in New River. But prior to that, they gave me a leave, and I got sick on the leave. I turned myself in at that time at the Naval Hospital in Philadelphia, which is no longer existent. And as a consequence, when I recovered, I was released and transferred to the Philadelphia Navy Yard, and I stayed there for about 6 months before I went to the advanced infantry training at New River. From New River, then I went across to San Diego. From San Diego, I went to New Caledonia. From New Caledonia, I went to Guadalcanal. From Guadalcanal, I went to Pavuvu. From Pavuvu, I went to Peleliu. From Peleliu, I went to back to Pavuvu. Then I went to Okinawa. From Okinawa, and then I went to Saipan, then Guam, then back to Okinawa. And I was getting ready. We were getting ready, already in training at that point, for the invasion of Japan. And the atomic bomb saved my life, because our outfit was scheduled to be one of the initial waves to hit the island of Honshu. The first island, Kyushu, was to be hit by the three Marine divisions, the third, fourth, and fifth. We're going to land in the southern end. That's about 60,000 men. They expected most of them to have been casualties. And at that time, that they would move the troops from Europe into, to move once we made the beachhead. The second part of that was the landing on Honshu, which was the main island in Japan. That was to be by the 1st Marine Division, the 2nd Marine Division, and the 3rd Marine Division. Again, approximately 60,000 men would make the beachhead, and then the army would move in directly from Europe.
You, if I understand correctly, though, those things did not happen because they dropped the bomb?
That's right. I say that the atomic bomb saved my life, because it was in my third invasion, and I had a feeling that my luck was starting to run out.
And so when you say it saved your life, you mean because the United States decided to use the bomb, many people who would have died in battle did not die in
That's
battle
right.
because
and
the battles did
the
not
Japanese.
Have to take place. Okay. What was your job assignment in the military?
I was basically in the 81mm mortars. It was my job to drop the shell into the tube, which the Marine Corps ran three-man crew on 81mm mortars, where the Army only would use two men. But by using a third man, we could fire more rapidly and more accurately.
So mortars were a form of ammunition?
No, well, mortars were a form of a weapon.
Okay.
We dropped the shells into the ammunition. And I also had a I was responsible for if the shell didn't go off, then I had to catch it coming out.
That sounds like quite a daring job.
Well, you're only allowed one error on something like that.
I guess so. The next question is, did you see combat? But obviously
yes.
You did.
Yes.
Okay. Were there any casualties in your unit?
Many, many, many. In fact, after the war, it was acknowledged that Peleliu should have never been invaded. The reason we invaded Peleliu was to protect General MacArthur's right flank in his invasion of the Philippines. But prior to the invasion, Admiral Halsey told Admiral Nimitz that he felt that wasn't needed because we had destroyed most of the air power Japan had in the Babelthorpe, in the Palau Islands, which Babelthorpe was the capital, and Peleliu was where we had the biggest airstrip, and there was no need for the invasion. However, Admiral Nimitz postponed one part of the invasion, which was the invasion of Yap Island, but he insisted on continuing performing, going through with Peleliu. As a consequence, we took quite a beating in Peleliu, and we had a lot of casualties.
What was your most memorable experience?
My most memorable experience for Peleliu basically was we were division reserves. As division reserves, we were not committed to the battle initially. As a consequence, we spent most of the day on a troop ship looking out at the island, watching the bombardments, watching the ships going in and out, watching the wounded coming back into our ship. But on 4:30, the call came in that reserves were needed. The Chesty Puller, who is a famous Marine legacy, was experiencing a lot of casualties. So by 4:30, we started to disembark to go ashore. We went down cargo nets, and by going down cargo nets with full gear is quite an experience because the troop ship is swaying in one direction and the Higgins boat is going in another direction. As a consequence, you find you extended yourself almost at a 45-degree angle trying to get off. And we had a few fellows that fell off. Fortunately, most of them were able to be recovered. But by the time the entire division disembarked, it was too late to really invade the island. So as a consequence, we tied up at next to an LST all night. We were off at the crack of dawn. We made the barrier reef, and the alligators that were there to pick us up at the barrier reef were not there, basically because we had lost a majority of them in the prior day in the initial phases of the campaign.
If I could stop you for 1 second, what is an alligator?
Alligator is a Amtrak vehicle, has tracks like a tank, but can traverse in either water or on the ground.
Okay.
And as a consequence, we get off of the barrier reef, they weren't there, and we had to wade in a good 100 yards, and we were like sitting ducks for Japanese snipers. And we had, additional to all our gear, I had to carry the base plate in, and that was about 50 pounds more. When we got to the beach, we were greeted by bloated bodies of Marines floating in and out with a crimson tide. And when we reached the beach, we found Marines in all grotesque positions, missing arms and legs. The stench of death was all over, filled with maggots. And the temperature was about 115. That was my introduction to combat.
Quite an experience. You mentioned Chesty Puller. Did you serve with Chesty Puller?
Oh, yes. I served with Chesty Puller. our battalion was committed to his part of the landing beach. And as a consequence, he became my commanding officer, my overall commanding officer. The invasion plan was to have Chesty Puller pick the attack, the Coral Beach. Colonel Hunt, who was the 5th Marines, was supposed to attack and capture the airport, and Hannigan, which was the 7th Marines, which was the 1st and 3rd, because the 2nd was the Battalion Reserve, we were Chesty Puller, he was also a Medal of Honor winner, was supposed to take the southern part of the island. And just to mention that also, I knew Carlton Rue was a Congressional Medal of Honor, who he threw himself down on hand grenades. He's a local boy. He was from Clementon, New Jersey. And he threw himself on a hand grenade and saved his group. And he's the only one that I recall that threw himself on a hand grenade and recovered. They sent him to Washington, to Australia. And make the story sound like a fairy tale. There he met his childhood sweetheart and he married her. She was an American nurse in Australia.
Were you awarded any medals or citations?
I had the Purple Heart, and the two I'm really proud of is a Presidential Unit Citation for both Peleliu and Okinawa.
And why did you receive the Purple Heart?
Well, believe it or not, it wasn't really due to Japanese action. This happened on Okinawa, and what happened toward the end of the campaign. The Japanese were retreating. They were retreating from defensive lines pre-established. And we were on the front lines for, I don't know how long, days. And we were very tired chasing them up and down the mountains. And beside carrying all our gear, I had to carry that base plate. That base plate alone weighed over 50 pounds. And as we were going up a mountain, I was carrying one and I tripped on a log. My hand fell on a rock and the base plate came down and broke my complete hand. And I stopped off at a first aid station and they tagged me. They wanted to send me out. I said, no. I said, I want to go back and join my outfit. Because I said, I can function yet. So this was the most stupid thing I ever did. So it was about 7 o'clock at night, and I knew approximately where they were going to be, but not exactly. And when I left the first aid station, I all at once felt so lonely because I was in no man's land and I didn't know who was around me. But I knew the shortest distance to where they were going to go was a straight line down the valley, and I ran like hell right through that distance in through the tall kunai grass that grows about our height. And fortunately, the Lord was with me, and fortunately I got there ahead of them, and I welcomed them there when they came. But when my lieutenant saw me, and he saw my hand, he basically reamed me out. He said, you're no help at all. He said, you can't fire a rifle, you can't drop a shell. And he said, you should have never come back here. He said, I should report you. But fortunately he didn't. The next day I was evacuated and I got my Purple Heart, but not because of the Japanese, but action was taken against them.
While you were in the service, how did you stay in touch with your family?
Through letters, and we had a specific type of mail, and I forgot, there's a name.
Vmail.
And basically, that's how he says. I used to write religiously to my mother and to assure her that everything was all right, not to worry about me and everything else. And I didn't correspond with really anybody else that much.
Now, V-mail, correct me if I'm wrong, but V-mail, first of all, it was heavily censored.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes, they read it before they...
And blocked out anything
yes.
that they thought you were saying that could give away any indication of where you were, information. And then I think it was also shrunken, wasn't it?
It was also what?
Shrunken. Did they make it very small?
Yes.
To cut down on the cost of sending
exactly
it.
That's exactly right. Thank you.
So, although you may have written a regular size letter, maybe 8.5 by 11, by the time your family got it, it was a little tiny four by five or something.
Yeah. I can assure you, I didn't write that long a letter. I just kept on to ensure my mother I was still in good shape.
What was the food like that you had to eat?
Rations, they were better than nothing, but not much better. But at times we took advantage of situations ourselves. In Okinawa, we were eating K rations for about 10 or 15 days, and we finally found a stray pig, and we turned around and we killed the pig. We didn't even let all the blood drain or anything else, and we had pork that night.
Did you have plenty of supplies?
Yes. I think one of the advantages that we had that the Japanese didn't have is that we had a lot of equipment, especially as the war grew. For every one we lost, we could put three in replacement, whether it was a battleship, an aircraft carrier, a rifle, whatever. And the poor Japanese, is when once they lost something, they couldn't have it replaced. So we had a big leg up on them.
Did you feel a lot of pressure or stress in these conditions?
Not really. I was at the right age. I was young. It was half an adventure to me and something I wanted to do. So I didn't feel any stress whatsoever. I'll tell you one thing, though. I think between the Marines and the Japanese, we hated each other. It wasn't like the war in Germany. You know, they say the Japanese would not be taken prisoners. Well, we helped the people that didn't want to be taken prisoners. We helped them. We killed them too. We really hated each other, but we respected each other as soldiers. For the Japanese, if they died for their country, that was their entrance to their heaven, and they fulfilled their obligation to their emperor.
Was there something special that you did for good luck?
Not really.
No four-leaf clovers?
I prayed, but that's not good luck. Somebody watch over me.
How did you entertain yourselves?
That's a good question. When we were in a rest camp, I played a lot of bridge. Played pinochle.
So these are card games?
Card games, that's right. And also we'd pour gasoline on land crabs and set them afire and watch them run. Let's see, what else did I do? And rats. Rats were atrocious down in the South Pacific. You know, when you approach an island in the breeze, it looked beautiful. Everything was green, and you said, oh, this is a beautiful place. I want to live here the rest of my life. But once you landed in 114-degree sun with the dampness, I had malaria 3 or 4 times. I had jungle rot. I had dengue fever. I had ringworm all over my body. And the South Pacific Islands aren't what people think they are. Believe me, they're very wet.
Were there any entertainers who came?
Yes. I saw Bob Hope, Jerry Colonna, Kay Francis.
When you got leave, what did you do on leave?
Well, I didn't get leave for 23 months. So the only thing I did could drink beer, go to the movies if I wanted to fight the crowd, or play cards.
So when you got leave, where were you?
My first leave I got was when I was in China. And then I It was in Tinson, which is an international city. And basically, we gorged ourselves on food and drink.
Do you have photographs from your time?
Yes, I have a scrapbook that my mother made for me. It's very dear to my heart. In fact, my son and my family turned around and they made a regular scrapbook and enhanced it, preserved some of the pictures we have. In it, I have a picture of Carlton Rue and some of the battle scenes that we were in.
What did you think of your fellow soldiers, infantrymen, officers?
My greatest friends were my Marine buddies. We would learn to trust each other. We would be foxhole at night, and you wanted to make sure that whoever had the watch was awake, because the Japanese used to infiltrate at night. As a consequence, we always stayed awake because we knew we were independent. We were dependent on each other. And I would, at night times, I would never throw a grenade out because by pulling the pin, you would give your position away. So I'd throw big chunks of coral, if I hear a noise, and would hopefully scare somebody off.
You said big chunks of coral?
Coral, yes, because a lot of it, especially Peleliu, was full of coral. In fact, one of the problems that we had is that we had to go in and dig them out of the holes. And they had so many tunnels and excavations in Peleliu that if you attacked one, they'd come out on the other end, maybe 10, 12 yards away from you and fire on you. But they were all interconnected. It was very difficult to get them out. That's why we had to use flamethrowers, especially when we started to have the tanks that would flamethrower, we could bring them up right to the coral and just pour gasoline and ignite it all over the place.
Did you keep a personal diary?
No, but to my surprise, I had a buddy, Swede Nelson, and we kept in touch after the war. And then he got cancer. And when he had cancer, I got the biggest surprise in my life. He had kept a diary. And he sent me a copy of it. And there's a lot of items in there that were true, and a couple of items that were wrong. But I really enjoyed it because it had quite a bit about me and my friends. And also, I also want to mention that besides keeping a diary, I was asked by some Veterans Association to attend an affair down in Washington, and they invited me down to attend it for when they showed the Pacific. Now, I don't know if the Pacific was written, but Steven Spielberg and Tom Hanks. What happened is that Steven Spielberg made a story of Private Ryan, which was based on Europe, but that had actually a story to it. So he wanted to do something for his father who served in the Pacific, so he decided to come out with a documentary of the Pacific. Now, the documentary was excellent. The thing that was wrong was it was about the 1st Marine Division. It wasn't about the other troops in the Pacific, and there were a lot of troops in the Pacific, so 1st Marine Division wasn't the only one. As a consequence, I felt sorry for all the other veterans who were there and didn't get acknowledged. But since I was in the 1st Marine Division, I really enjoyed it.
Do you remember the day your service ended?
The day my service ended? I remember a couple of things when the day my service ended. I remember going back, as I say, I was a casual, and going back after I spent 4 or 5 weeks at Saipan in the hospital to recover from malaria, to recover from my hand. Every time I got something else would occur. So what happened, finally on August 8th, I'm on my way back to my outfit in Okinawa. And they announcement came that Japan had capitulated. But just about 2 hours before that, my LST that I was on had broken down. And I'm watching the rest of the convoy sail off in the sunset. And I'm turning around. The captain gave us 2 cans of warm beer, 10 cents apiece. I'm sitting on the fantail, stripped to the waist, watching a fantail go off and drinking this warm beer and saying, some damn fool nip sub isn't going to get the word and he's going to sink this tub. But I finally made it.
Where were you located when you were discharged from the service?
I was, when I came back, I was at Great Lakes in Illinois, and I was discharged from there.
And what did you do in the days and weeks immediately after your discharge?
I think in 3 days I went to work.
Was that in Great Lakes? Did you come back home?
No, I came back home. I told my mother and father I'd be home at a later time than I knew I'd be home. So they're there, they won't be anxious or anything else. I came home 7 o'clock in the morning. My father and my mother came down, they were glad to see me. My father brought out a bottle that he had kept because liquor was rationed at that time. And I remember sitting there just talking to my father and casually drinking this liquor and drinking quite a bit of it. And then my mother called relatives and came over to the house. They all came over later and we had a dinner and a good time, and that was it.
And what year was this?
It was around February 1st, 1946.
Okay. Did you go back to school? You went right to a job?
Yes. Well, one of the things that the service taught me is that basically with an education, you had a better chance for advancement. So that I learned that from the Marine Corps. So I worked for 4 months or so, because my marks were terrible in high school. I wasn't a good student at all. So I finally got accepted at a junior college, the College of South Jersey, which is now Rutgers of South Jersey. From there, I transferred to Temple and got my bachelor's degree in accounting. And then later, when I worked for RCA, I got a master's degree.
And so you, after school, you worked for RCA Victor Company in Camden?
One of the companies, yes.
One of the companies, okay. You said you worked when you first got back. What did you do?
Radio condenser. I worked as an inspector of radio condenser.
When you went to school, did you use the GI Bill?
Yes. Okay. Took complete advantage of it.
Did you make any very close friendships while you were in the service, and did you continue those relationships afterwards?
I met a lot of close friends, but unfortunately, as time went by, I just rarely communicated with them.
Did you join any veterans organizations?
Oh yes, I'm a member of the Marine Corps League in Oakland. I think it's Detachment 1775, but I'm not sure.
So your career after the war was mainly working as what?
Accounting. I ended my final position in RCA where I was a financial director of a division in RCA, Government Communication System Division, located in Camden.
Did your military experience influence your thinking about war or the military in general?
Yes.
How so?
Let me see how I can put it. I believe this country has become too lenient. I think this country is certainly decaying to an extent. I'm concerned about the youth of this country. I think we have to return back to the areas that really built this country, like individual people being responsible for their actions, and the need for us to take actions when we're attacked. And this is today's environment.
Do you attend any reunions? Have you attended any reunions?
I have attended reunions, but at my age, it's difficult to travel an extensive period of time. I haven't gone for a while. And most of them, people I would have reunions with, they're passed away.
But you did attend them in their past, and were they?
I attended one or two of them in the past.
Were these reunions of your unit?
Yes.
How did your service and the experiences you had affect your life?
Well, it made me appreciate life and the things that are in there, but it also taught me that I'm responsible. I should be held responsible for my actions, and to really be self-sufficient and independent.
Is there anything you would like to add that we've not covered in this interview?
No, it's just that I think we live in a great country, and I think basically that every effort should be made to maintain that.
Okay. All right. Well, that concludes the interview. I thank you very much.
Thank you.
I know future generations will enjoy looking at this and seeing how your generation helped our country and preserved our country.
Thank you.